Boom. Right on the mark. 6 o'clock on this Thursday morning, November 16th. This is Up North News Radio. I'm Pat Kreitlow. Greg Bach and Waukesha will be along in a sec. Nice to have you all here. Coming up this morning, we'll talk a bit about a government shutdown being averted, but some far-right Republicans are not happy about it at all. We'll also talk to our friend Joe Specky about goings on at the legislature. Several bipartisan things happened. Not bipartisan by nature, but just because that's the way these particular issues broke, and Joe will talk about that. In our second hour, Hometown Health, we're going to be talking about the childhood vaccination rate in Wisconsin. It's rather troubling, and there is a tipping point at which you're really affecting the immunity of an entire population here in Wisconsin. So Kristen Lyerly and a guest will have our Hometown Health segment. We've got a forecast that's going to be changing quite a bit from very warm and very windy to very chilly to start the weekend. So Jennifer Vucicki will have the forecast for us as well. That's all coming up at 6:06 when we get this little radio show started. If you're watching later on video, you just got to fast forward about, 4 minutes or so, and we'll see you soon.
Health organization said the operation was totally unacceptable.
They're swamped in parts of South Florida. An intense storm has turned streets into rivers in places like North Hollywood and Miami.
I can't drive it. There's too much water. It's crazy.
We hope for...
Mid-air, 4 minutes after liftoff. The two-hour launch window tomorrow opens at 8 a.m. Eastern. After a warning letter from the FDA, Amazon has agreed to stop selling 7 different types of eye drops. None had been approved for sale in the U.S., nor recognized as safe and effective. They claim to help with problems like pink eye, dry eyes, eye strain, and floaters. In a statement, Amazon says safety is a top priority. This is CBS News.
Make the hiring process work for you. With Indeed's end-to-end hiring solution, you can attract, interview, and hire candidates all from one place. Start at Indeed.com/credits.
The RPG came through the belly of the aircraft. We don't talk about the female combat wounded. These are our daughters and our sisters and our mothers. Wounded Warrior Project came into my life and taught me how to stand back up and get back in.
For Civic Media News, I'm Nate Ruggiehout. Here's what Wisconsin needs to know. There's a run on new opportunities for high-speed internet in rural Wisconsin. The state has $42 million worth of grants to give out, but the number of applications it got asked for more than 221 million. More than 251,000 locations in Wisconsin still lack service, and about as many have internet that's below current standards. The Public Service Commission will now start poring over the applications. People who help their older and disabled loved ones at home for no money are asking for help from the state of Wisconsin. Martha Cranley is director of AARP Wisconsin.
Each year, Wisconsin's unpaid family caregivers provide about 538 million hours of care to their parents, spouses, and partners, and they do it for no pay.
A bill called the CARE Act would require hospitals to work with caregivers to make sure they're getting what they need. I'm Nate Wiggehout, Civic Media News.
Jordan Love says the Packers are getting better. Hi, I'm Mike Clemens with sports. The Packers back at practice, although the team has lost 4 of their last 5 games. Quarterback Jordan Love says the offense is getting better thanks to receivers like rookie Jaden Reed.
He's not thinking. He knows what he's doing. He knows where he needs to get to and do some good things after the catch.
The Packers host the Chargers on Sunday. The WIAA State High School Football Championships are today and tomorrow at Camp Randall in Madison. Divisions 4 through 7 today, 1 through 3 tomorrow. Baseball, the Brewers introducing Pat Murphy as the new manager. Players like Christian Yelich supporting the hire. NBA, the last time the Bucks played in Toronto, they got blown out. Last night, they returned the favor with a 128-112 victory over the Raptors, and they did it with Giannis out with a sore calf muscle. Damian Lillard led Milwaukee with 37 points. The Bucks' Brooke Lopez.
You know, he did a great job leading us offensively, making sure everyone was in their spots, getting people involved, being himself.
With sports, I'm Mike Clement.
Here's your updated forecast on the Shaw. Partly cloudy today. Daytime highs approaching 64. Southwesterly winds 10 to 15 miles an hour. Chance for scattered showers tonight, 41. Daytime highs approaching 44 tomorrow. For Civic Media, I'm meteorologist Derek Height. Currently, it's 43 degrees.
This is your hometown radio, refreshed. Keeping you informed, entertained, and connected locally across the Civic Media Network. Waukesha, home of Les Paul, our awesome farmers market, and the Shaw, 540 AM and 101.1 FM, WAUK, UK.
All across Wisconsin from Civic Media, this is Up North News Radio. Now, live from our Lake Wissota studio, here's the founding editor of Up North News, Pat Breitlow.
Well, hey there, Wisconsin. Good morning. It's Thursday, November 16th. It's another beautiful day up north. Nice to have you here from wherever you're listening across the Civic Media Radio Network or on the Civic Media app by podcast or a live video feed on social media. I got a question for you. Christmas or holiday cards, whatever you send out, do you use still the traditional cards that you sign and stick in an envelope? Or do you now get photo cards from the big retailers like Shutterfly and Snapfish and Walmart, etc.? And however you do it, do you include a letter or do you just sign it? Or do you not even sign it anymore because it's just a photo that goes in the envelope? It's time to make some decisions, people, because we are now in the second half of November. And time to start thinking about the holidays. So we'll talk about that question in a bit. A couple of other things that are on tap this morning. There might not be a government shutdown this week, but far-right members of Congress are not among those who are happy about it. Instead, they're asking each other to name one thing they've accomplished this year. And frankly, something similar could be said about the legislature, where a popular project for the UW College of Engineering remains stuck in a political quagmire. We'll talk to Joe Zepecki about that. Hometown Health in our second hour. Some doctors are very concerned about the childhood vaccination rates in Wisconsin, that the state's exemption standards are too lax to ensure public health won't be affected by a larger non-immunized population. And so we will look at how people playing politics with healthcare are jeopardizing all of us. We've got a forecast that's warm and windy as the day goes on, but then it's going to get cool in a hurry by tomorrow. Meteorologist Jennifer Huchitsky from Weatherology will tell us more about that. And along the way, you can add your input at 844-967-2789. Call it or text us. Use the Civic Media app. Email us, radio@upnorthnewswi.com. And if you're watching the show on the Civic Media Facebook page or the Up North News Facebook page, put a comment there. We'll see it and maybe put it up on screen as well. 6 a.m. temperatures on this Thursday. Everybody's in the, not everybody's in the 40s. There's a little fluctuation here, but it's a pretty consistent range. 47 here on Lake Wissota and 47 in Hayward, 46 in Park Falls. Wausau at 43, Green Bay 39. Oshkosh is 43 right now. La Crosse reporting 50. Wisconsin Rapids 48, Madison 44, and Waukesha 43. And again, warm and the winds picking up today, but then a cool down for the weekend is on the way. So 43 in Waukesha, that's where we find one Greg Bach, who, in honor of you, because I see our Thursdays are sometimes a little rough. You know, they kind of get started. So I'm not waiting till Friday. I've got the Roy Kent mug out right away on this Thursday.
Oh, I love Roy Kent.
I do too, and that's really all we can say. We can't say any of the other things that he says. If you're still not a Ted Lasso watcher. The series is, and I say this for good reason. I was one of those people that had to come back to it. Like, honestly, a third time. Like, the first two times I was like, this is goofy. I don't know. And people said, no, stick with it. And then I realized these same people got me off the schneid when I was slow to embrace Schitt's Creek. And then
which
restarted.
Which we can say.
We can say that. It's a TV show, people. And then we ended up loving it. And Ted Lasso was the same way. And the Roy Kent character is just truly what makes it, especially in that first season. So the Roy Kent mug is out in honor of Thursday being a little rough sometimes. I think for me, in part, it was because I'm realizing we're in the second half of November. So, Mr. Bach, where are you on your Christmas holiday cards? Do you send them at all? And what kind of format do they take?
We don't send them at all. Every year I want to send them, but I don't. We don't. But I would like to do
I'm
that.
Sorry, I feel like I stepped into a case of the newlywed game here. I didn't mean to pry on, you know, private home decisions. But
No.
But tell us more about why your wife hates the holidays, Greg. Go ahead. We're set.
Well, she hates Christmas. She's all about the holidays. She doesn't say Merry Christmas. I don't know what's going on there. I don't know why I do Southern. That's so rude.
Well, on top of that, you already stepped on, you know, our next topic. It's Red Cup Day for Starbucks. And remember how they get in trouble every year because they don't say Christmas on the cups. They got bigger issues to worry about today. So many of their workers, the union ones are on strike. The non-union ones have walked out today. If you're planning on Starbucks today, folks, plan on a wait. Because
thanks for the heads up.
Yeah, well, same issue as other places like Walgreens, CVS. People are tired of being understaffed and overworked. And so they're protesting that today. But we'll get back to that later. I've gotten ahead of myself. So the cards do not go out. If you had your druthers.
Yeah.
How do I keep coming up with these old man words? But if you did have those druthers, what would your preference be?
I say we don't send out the holiday cards, and that really sticks in my craw. Here's what I do. There'd be two versions. Mm-hmm. There'd be one that we just send a basic Christmas card out to. Mm-hmm. And then for like certain family members, write a little letter. You know, this is what we did this year. This is what's going on. Not everyone gets a letter because not everyone cares, you know?
Yep.
But I know, you know, in my head, I want to hand write them. So I'd only do like 10 or 15 of them.
Yes.
But yeah, I mean, we will get to it because we just bought a house last year and I'm like, well, now we have a house. Like, by the way, listening public, everyone, especially you folks in Chippewa Waffles, this isn't my wife like dive bombing the idea. It's we talk about it every year, like, let's do it. And then we're like, bleep.
So just time gets in the way and everything else.
Absolutely.
Text from Waukesha says, how did we go right from Halloween to New Year's Day? Honestly, it's both a slog and a sprint at the same time this particular season here. We used to do a letter, especially when you're raising kids, you wanted, you know, the kids are doing this and the kids are doing that. And we realized that other couples, once they became empty nesters and we were the same way. It's like, well, we could talk about our kids and grandkids, but that's their letter. That's their card.
Yeah.
You know, what are we going to do? We came home last night and we played cribbage. And then the next night, we came home and we played cribbage. And the next night, we came home and we watched a movie. There's our year, folks. So,
are you guys good cribbage players?
I don't know if we're good, but we've played like thousands of games over the years, it feels like. Yeah. So we've never like tested that against other people. In fact, wouldn't it be great if Sherry and I did finally start going like into like these little local tournaments or whatever, only to find out we'd been playing it wrong all these years, that we had like Calvin ball rules or something like that. But no,
count 15, not 16. Who taught you this?
Right. So we got people thinking about their cards one way or another, and we would love to know your own feedback at 844-967-2789. And do you have any novel, you know, suggestions that way? Maybe instead of, you know, the big retailers like Shutterfly and Walmart or whatnot, maybe there's, do you use a local place, a local photo processor or something like that, that you want to give somebody an idea to? I know that we're getting set probably to use Shutterfly again, because it's easy to throw, you know, six photos on a card with all the kids and grandkids, you know, and then, you know, stamp at the Kreitlows, and it feels terribly impersonal, but like you said, you got so much to do during the season, right?
Yeah,
you
know? It's just check my blog.
Check my blog. Well, that's the other thing is like the letter used to be great because you wouldn't hear from anybody all year long. And they go, oh, it's so nice to catch up. Now you see every day I had avocado toast today. Exactly. And the dog had a regular movement. And, you know, it's, I see more of a letter every day. I don't need the year end thing necessarily.
I'll just make a Christmas card. And on one side, it'll be me, Bridget and myself. Mm-hmm. And the other side, it'll just be my top 30 tweets. Just,
oh, I like that. Yes. Top 30 tweets.
You're caught up.
Especially the ones that are rather vague. Like, how could that happen? You know, because you're watching a Packer game or something and nobody has any context whatsoever. So we'll take your ideas on that. Over on Up North News on the social media site, on Facebook, for example, you'll see Up North News stories about Governor Evers proposing some changes that will ease lockdowns and improve conditions at prisons in Wisconsin. Also, several options for supporting Wisconsin farmers at your Thanksgiving table. So head to upnorthnewswi.com or upnorthnewswi, search for that on Facebook to find some of what we're putting. And over on the website, you can get our daily newsletter, click newsletter in the top banner. And as far as this radio version of Up North News, if you can't catch us live every morning, catch us as a podcast. Head to your favorite Apple, Spotify, what have you, and take care of business that way or through the Civic Media website. What do we have here from Michael Seal on Facebook? We make our own cards with a short letter printed inside. The outside is public domain images, and it is sent to everyone on our list. I like that. I don't know that I necessarily have the time or the skill for that, but you know, it's definitely something worth looking into. Let's start with Congress here as we unpack the news and right-wing Republicans who are really not happy with their new Speaker of the House. Here is an audio clip from Texas Congressman Chip Roy, one of the most extreme members of Congress, and he's kind of oversharing how he's feeling right now about what Republicans have done since they took control of the House.
One thing. I want my Republican colleagues to give me one thing, one, that I can go campaign on and say we did. One. Anybody sitting in the complex, if you want to come down to the floor and come explain to me one material, meaningful, significant thing the Republican majority has done besides, well, I guess it's not as bad as the Democrats.
There's Congressman Chip Roy from Texas. And don't think for a moment that Democrats aren't going to play that one on a loop all throughout the 2024 campaign. Because again, yes, there was a stopgap measure that prevented having a crisis over the holiday weekend, but they only did kick the can down a couple of months. There's still plenty of time for the far right to shut down the government. But as of yesterday, old Chip there and 18 other extremists were still having such a hissy fit, they blocked consideration of one of the interim spending bills just to make a point to Speaker Mike Johnson that he's got to do one of two things, either be true to his right-wing tribe or grind the U.S. government to a halt, or he could be a national leader, negotiate fairly with the Senate, and get some things done that both parties can point to as accomplishments, but then his right wing will abandon him. Do you feel the earth moving under your feet yesterday? We'll answer that question coming up in just a moment here. But again, a reminder, head over to upnorthnewswi.com to see more of what we do. Sign up for our newsletter and maybe pick up t-shirts and tote bags as well. Back in just a little over 30 seconds, wherever you're listening across Wisconsin this morning, when you're here, you're up north.
Shaw, WAUK.
Earn extra cash for the holidays. Visit Robert Hack Diamonds for their gold buying event November 15th through the 18th. They'll buy your gold for real green, and you could walk away with tickets to see the green and gold score a touchdown in Green Bay. Score top dollar with an offer on the spot for your unwanted gold, silver, and diamonds, all in a relaxed atmosphere. Get free professional valuations from a local name and trusted company. You'll learn exactly what you have and what it's worth with the international experience at Robert Hack Diamonds. Did you inherit jewelry that may not be to your taste but is sentimental? Why not convert it to something new and exciting? or trade in your outdated pieces for something new. So many options. Robert Hack is having their gold buying event November 15th through the 18th and is paying cash for your unwanted gold, silver, and diamonds. See them in Brookfield, just east of Moreland on Greenfield Avenue, or right on the corner of 76th and Layton in Greenfield. Visit RobertHackDiamonds.com.
The Shaw, WAUK.
Still ahead, Joseph Pecky, Dr. Kristen Lyerly, and Hometown Health on this Thursday morning. Turns out there was a magnitude 3.6 earthquake that rattled northern Illinois and parts of Wisconsin and Iowa as well on early Wednesday. That's according to the U.S. Geological Survey. The quake was detected yesterday about 4:41 in the morning, centered about 100 miles southwest of downtown Chicago. Greg, I don't know that you're close enough. That was there any chatter at all? Did anybody felt anything untoward down there early yesterday morning?
Oh, first of all, great use of the word untoward.
I'm an old also, man.
No, I know. I'm never going to criticize you for using great phrases and or words.
What was the one I used yesterday that you said I used properly?
Myriad.
Myriad, use, yes.
Yeah, I hear so many people say use myriad incorrectly, and it just, like, it's like, it's like nails on a chalkboard for me.
I'll always be your little word nerd, Greg. So, did you feel the earth move? And I'm not referring to that question.
No, I didn't. So we live in Kenosha, so we're just in southern Wisconsin. Okay. And when you said three, I was like, oh, I mean, I know that everyone's speaking at like 1 or 1.5, and mm-hmm. it's not that big of a deal, but for Wisconsin, 3, I feel like it's huge.
Yeah, it was 3 miles below the Earth's surface, and folks in some of those parts of those states and Northwest Indiana as well. Some people said that they felt it. The thing is, we had Christina Laurie on about 3 weeks ago, because she had put a story in our daily newsletter about how small earthquakes do happen around Wisconsin. So in a Journal Sentinel story, there's a note about there was a mini quake below Waupaca County in 2012. And there was in 1968, a 5.3 in the central part of the U.S. that was felt in Wisconsin. And an even larger one shook the region in 1947. So they're not impossible to have. They're very rare. But, you know, it's one of those things. Someday you just might feel. It's one of those things we say to our friends from other coasts. They say, why do you stay there in the winter? Because, you know, we know the snowstorm is coming. We know severe weather is coming. You don't know when the earth is going to start shaking. That would freak me out.
My sister-in-law used to live in Los Angeles, and I was staying there once, and there it was minor, like 4 or 5. It wasn't that big of a deal to them. But I woke up and just shaking. I'm like, what's going on? They're like, it's a little earthquake. I'm like, no, don't say little. That's like saying I had a mild heart attack. Had the earth shifted. Can we be honest?
Small nuclear explosion. It's just a small one. It's fine. The thing I think people don't appreciate when it comes to earthquakes and what the earth is capable of doing. One of my favorite writers is Bill Bryson. And one of my favorite books from him isn't one of the usual travel books. It's one called A Short History of Nearly Everything. And in it, he talks about the Yellowstone caldera. Because basically, Yellowstone is sitting on, as he puts it, a vast bowl of unstable magma. And again, that's one of those words you can say on the radio, even though it sounds like you shouldn't. But magma is okay.
Magma.
There are about 30 of these huge areas of unstable magma around the world. All of them except one, however, are underneath the ocean's crust. That one would be Yellowstone. The volcano there first erupted 16 million years ago. It's blown about 100 times since. And they say if Yellowstone were to erupt again, the ash would have enormous consequences for the climate and human populations. Bryson points out another eruption is quite possible, as the Yellowstone supervolcano is active and overdue. And the first time I read all of that, my daughter lives like, you know, a stone's throw from Yellowstone. And I thought, well, this is awful. Then I realized if that thing blows the way they say it's going to blow, she won't even know. The rest of us are going to be screwed if that thing were to ever have something that epic. But it's, you know, what happened yesterday was a good reminder that, again, always bet on nature. Lay the points.
That's what I always say. Mm-hmm. Nature will always win.
Yes, nature is undefeated.
Yeah,
in whatever form that it might take. Let's see. Tommy here writes in, relocated from California. They're not so bad.
Okay.
All right, Tommy.
Was it Tommy or Tammy?
Again, it's Thursday. I can't see up. By Thursday, my contacts are shot. It's Tammy.
Tammy Winkleplek, who used to live in California, mm-hmm. deserves to have the... Pat, come on. You're a word nerd.
Right. Yeah, that's right. I said word nerd. I love the words. The eyesight, sometimes not so much.
I love the words. I did see this, and I wish I had more information, but there was an earthquake. There was a volcano that went off in Japan, mm-hmm. and it formed an island.
Mm-hmm.
It was underwater, and it just started like basically creating an island. I'm like, that's amazing.
I know. Well, a lot of them are that way. That's how we get all of our best islands, you know, is through a little activity that way. A quick turn on sports before we hear from Joe Zepecki, and I'm going to ask Joe Zepecki about this as well. But Greg, Pat Murphy is manager. Any thoughts up or down on there?
So I have some good, I want to keep some good thoughts. I think what's good about it is that, you know, he worked under Craig Council, so he knows Craig's methods on the team. So he doesn't just come in cold. I think there's some good stuff there. I don't know how much fire and energy you have. Once again, listening public, I'm just saying he's an older gent with a 3-year contract. I don't know how much he wants to put into this. Mm-hmm. I hope he wants a ring. But we had Mike Clemens on yesterday, and he felt like this is just it's not the best move for the Brewers. But I also think if you bring in a brand new person, then we're almost guaranteed we're not going anywhere for like 4 or 5 years.
Is he the interim, though? Is he the interim for the real future of the Brewers, which is the new associate manager, Ricky Weeks?
Well, that's the thing, is Ricky Weeks has shot up through the ranks, and that was mm-hmm. he's associate manager. I mean, that's amazing. And
you mean assistant to the manager? How does that work? No, assistant manager.
He's the assistant to the regional manager. The problem I have is that, you know, is this just a move to make people buy tickets to see Ricky Weeks? Because, mm-hmm. you know, what does he bring exactly? And I'm not saying that like he's no good. I'm just, you know, I don't know.
We're all curious.
Yes, exactly. It'll be interesting to see where the Brewers are, honestly, in like 5 years' time.
Yes, but the same could be said about the Packers and about Badger mm-hmm. football. I think we have entered. You've heard of the transfer portal? We're in the transition portal. We don't know where this comes out the other side, but theoretically, this could be, you know, the start of some good things for maybe at least one of these teams. At least you hope so. Let's hope so. Coming up an hour from now, Jimmy Koska is going to be here, and we will talk about the state high school football championships. They get started today over at Camp Randall. You have more sports coming up in a bit, though. I will say Damian Lillard had 37 points as the Bucks beat Toronto 118-112. They play tomorrow night at Charlotte, Saturday at home against Dallas, and you can catch the Bucks all across the Civic Media Radio Network, including Oshkosh Air Support, Lake Erin Amory, News from the Center in Richland Center, 98Q Country in Park Falls, and WRJN in Racine. Let's see, the Marquette women's basketball team was in action last night, and they won at Ooey Pooey. We can't let that one go without one more reference. They will next play Sunday afternoon at home against St. Peter's. So when we come back, Joe Zepecki, we've not touched much on state politics because a lot has happened in the legislature a couple days back, and we wanted to go through it all with Joe Zepecki. So we'll have that conversation in just a sec. Again, this is Up North News Radio. Nice to have you here for a Thursday morning. And you tenderly call my name. I know that my emotions are something I just can't tame. I just got to have your baby. Yeah. I feel the earth move.
Okay. CBS News Brief. We begin with high-stakes negotiations overseas. CBS News has learned of a possible deal in the works between Israel and Hamas that could lead to the release of some of the hostages being held in Gaza. would include Israel agreeing to a 3 to 5 day pause in fighting. And Israel's military has released video of what it claims are Hamas weapons found at Al-Shifa Hospital in Gaza. Word came late last night on Capitol Hill.
I have good news for the American people. This Friday night, there will be no government shutdown.
Senate Majority Leader Chuck Schumer, after lawmakers voted 87 to 11 to approve a temporary funding package. Presidents Biden and Xi held their first face-to-face meeting in a year and agreed to reopen military communications between the U.S. and China. Expert Jack Werner warns.
It still remains the case that there are these deep structural problems.
CBS News Brief. I'm Deborah Rodriguez.
For Civic Media News, I'm Nate Wegehout. Here's what Wisconsin needs to know. Governor Evers is lifting lockdowns at state prisons in Waupun and Green Bay. Inmates have been confined to their cells for months because of safety worries and not enough guards. Inmates will soon get access to more prison programs, and some inmates in Waupun will be moved out. The governor says he's also keen on hiring more guards. Starting pay for those jobs went up to $33 an hour in the new state budget. More young people are taking part in Wisconsin's registered apprenticeship program than ever before. The paid training program combines on-the-job learning and education from technical colleges and private training centers. More than 16,000 apprentices are taking part. That's the highest number in the program's 112 years. Workforce development officials say the program is a way to bring job seekers and employers together. I'm Nate Wegehout, Civic Media News.
Menards 11% sale ends Thanksgiving Day. Add insulation to your home with Owens Corning Foamular Insulation Panels. Walls, floors, and basements. Foamular insulation can create a more comfortable living space while reducing your energy costs. Look for the pink panels in store and save today. Save 11% now on all insulation products at Menards. Stores close Thanksgiving, but 11% off remains in effect on Menards.com. Savings are mail-in rebates and exclusions apply. See store for details.
Save big money at Menards.
Your hometown radio refreshed. This is the Civic Media Radio Network.
Here's your updated forecast on the Shaw. Partly cloudy today. Daytime highs approaching 64. Southwesterly winds 10 to 15 miles an hour. Chance for scattered showers tonight, 41. Daytime highs approaching 44 tomorrow. For Civic Media, I'm meteorologist Derek Height. Currently, it's 43 degrees.
Roll into this Friday night and strike a chord of fun, food, and music at Foxview Lanes in Waukesha. A Friday night live music party kicks off at 8 p.m. and goes until midnight every Friday night. And the best part of this party? There's no cover charge. While you're having fun, grab dinner and take advantage of $2 off all sandwiches on Friday night. This Friday night, enjoy the music of American Graffiti, 2440 West Sunset Drive in Waukesha. Call 262-544-2010 or check out foxviewlanes.com. You're listening to The Shaw, WAUK.
For adults with moderate to severe plaque psoriasis who are candidates for systemic or phototherapy, now there's Skyrizi, risankizumab riza, a prescription-only 150-milligram injection. With Skyrizi, 3 out of 4 people achieve 90% clear skin at 4 months, and Skyrizi is just 4 doses a year after 2 starter doses.
Nothing in me go hand in hand. Nothing on my skin, that's my new place. Nothing is
Don't use if allergic to Skyrizi. Serious allergic reactions and an increased risk of infections or a lower ability to fight them may occur. Before treatment, your doctor should check for infection and tuberculosis. Tell your doctor if you have an infection or symptoms, such as fever, sweats, chills, muscle aches, or cough, or if you plan to or recently received a vaccine.
With Skyrizi, you could achieve 90% clearer skin. Ask your doctor about the number one dermatologist prescribed biologic in psoriasis and visit Skyrizi.com or call 1-866-SKYRIZI to learn more.
Whether you're heading down Les Paul Parkway or fighting traffic on the interstates, this is The Shaw, 540 AM and 101.1 FM, WAUK.
Thirty.
34. It's a Thursday morning. Eric's chosen. Back. He is here. He is fired up, ready to go. I could just tell from the moment I turned the camera on. And Joe, how are you? He's fired up.
Fired up and ready to go. Yeah, okay. It's one of those weeks.
Okay. I'm not sure where to begin on all this. Again, glass half empty, half full. Let's go with that theme of bipartisanship, if that's what you want to call it, on both the stadium bill and the overhaul of alcohol laws. And I wanted to know, should we read anything into this about how the legislature is handling or should handle issues down the road? Or is this just one of those things that reminds us every so often that, you know, not everything cuts neatly down party lines and, you know, these things just happen to be noteworthy? What'd you think of the outbreak of alleged bipartisanship?
I thought it was nice. I do think it's nice. I also think it's a little demonstrative of just how ridiculous our politics are, because you and I know, Pat, what the percentages are, what range they are in, of bills that actually pass a legislature and get signed into law that have bipartisan support, which is to say at least one member of each party supporting them. It's almost all of them, right? Okay. That's your experience in the legislature. It's almost all of them.
Yeah.
But the share of volume goes entirely to the stuff that only one party supports and the other party opposes. So one of the things I'm fired up about this week is the media and their role, traditional media, in perpetuating the fault lines in our politics and in our society and in our culture and in our communities. Because most things people of good faith can find some areas of agreement on, find some areas of disagreement on, work together and find a way forward. That is what we saw this week. Listen, I haven't exactly made secret the notion that we're giving, you know, state tax dollars to professional sports franchises is pretty infuriating to me. And I'm a huge sports fan. Mm-hmm. And I believe that the state has a role to play in economic development. But this one, it just strikes me as it's tough. But I can also put on a perspective and say, this was a better deal when it was done for taxpayers than what the Brewers initially proposed. There is some value to this in keeping the franchise here for at least another 20 years. If we can use this as leverage to foster even more economic development around the stadium, that would be a good thing. I can find the positives in a deal, even if it was one that I was inclined not to like from jump. Mm-hmm. When we talk about the three-tier system in this state, governing alcohol sale and distribution, and, you know, this was a long time coming. And when you've got everybody from Molson Coors, you know, a international, like one of the biggies, Quick Trip, which has become very big, but started out as like a very small, you know, local Wisconsin business that is a distributor, and New Glarus, which is only in Wisconsin, and all of the different interest groups who are involved in this for years and years and years to get to three-tier system reform, there shouldn't be much controversy if folks say this is an update and a modernization of the system. And yet when you read the coverage, it's all about wedding barns. And I'm not suggesting that if you own a wedding barn, you may not be like hacked off today, but also you can probably figure out a way to spend a couple of $100 to go get the license you need to in a way that is now consistent with a law that both Republicans and Democrats thought was a good idea. So why is like 80% of the conversation in the coverage about the small number of wedding barn owners crying foul and not about the years-long process from all of the stakeholders to get to a good solution? And the answer is it doesn't make for good content. There's not enough fighting in it. And it is that approach that leads to the nonsense that we saw on Tuesday in Washington, D.C., where you've got a kidney punch from Kevin McCarthy. You've got Senator Mark Wayne Mullen from Oklahoma standing up and threatening to fight a Teamster official in a Senate committee hearing. And frankly, Tuesday night, we all saw a brawl in an NBA game. We got to stop fighting and use our words, Pat. That's one of the things that has me fired up, even 2 days later.
You know what really has people fired up about the alcohol bill was the process of it. And again, this is one of those shows where we're going to go into the weeds on this, because I find it curious. I think maybe the average listener would too, once we explain it. So this alcohol overhaul, which you said was years and years in the making, it had passed the assembly some time ago, a couple months ago now, it feels like. Mm-hmm. And it was bottled up in the Senate because it went to a committee. The committee chair did not like the bill, so he didn't bring it up for a vote in committee. So the Republican majority leader, Devin LeMahieu, kind of had to do an end run to get the bill attached to a different bill. My question to you is, as a fellow, you know, insider, what good is a committee chair if you can't use the power of the chair to bottle up the bills that you don't like? And should that committee chair step down if his majority leader is just going to end run him like that?
Well, let's back up and just add the context that it passed the assembly like 90-4 or something. I mean, it was like this was not like a 50-49 vote. And then the committee chair was like, well, this is really complicated. It'd be really hard to get to yes and get to a workable majority. So we're just going to take our time, let some of the air out, you know, the steam out of the kettle. No, it's one person. And what I will say is I am glad to see that there are mechanisms in place in a system of checks and balances that if the overwhelming majority of a legislative body wants to see something happen, they can find a way to make it happen.
Excuse me, I have to sneeze for a second here. Tommy Tuberville.
Right, okay, right. Because the inverse of this is when one single United States senator can hold up 300 senior military promotions and put a hold on things, and it grinds government to a halt. That is not good for anyone. And so I have no problem with the, you know, LeMahieu using the machinations of Robert's rules of orders and the rules of the Senate to get this thing done. Sometimes that's what you have to do. Sometimes the system has to guard against one single person trying to just stand athwart history and progress and yell stop.
Yes, and I'm being a bit hyperbolic about the committee chair stepping down because, frankly, he gets to save face, to say, look, I stuck to my principles on this, and the majority leader found another way to get it done. Nobody twisted my arm. So in that way, yes, the process worked as it basically is supposed to. One thing that continues to be bottled up in the state capitol that so many people want is the expanded and new school or college of engineering building on the UW-Madison campus. And so Kelly Meyerhofer over at the Journal Sentinel did a great attempt, emphasis on attempt and no fault to her, to get all 132 legislators on the record as far as why is this popular project still being bottled up? What was your takeaway from the responses and the non-responses?
First of all, this is great reporting by Kelly. And if you read one thing this week that is not published by UpNorthNewsWI.com, make it this story in the Journal Sentinel. Because I'd like to see more of this on more issues. But this one is such a no-brainer slam dunk. When you have the business community and the university in alignment in saying, we need a new engineering building. We don't need it because we want a new fancy building. We need it because the state's employers need engineers. There is a shortage, and the kids we are losing out on are not going to smaller UW schools. They are going to other Big Ten schools. And these engineering jobs that start at an average of like $75,000 a year are really good jobs. This is, you know, $300 million for a building, not all of which is going to be paid by the state, because there's more than $100 million in private donations. But like, it's the state's flagship university. We need the engineers. WMC is behind it. If WMC can't get this done, what the hell is the point of WMC? And for Republican legislators who are willing to go on the record to say, we're holding this hostage because we don't like some other policy that the University of Wisconsin is doing, and for the vast majority of Republicans to bury their head in the sands and refuse to engage or answer is such cowardice in public office. It is grounds on its own, in my view, for them to be voted out of office. I don't care if I agree with you on 99 issues out of 100. If you cannot answer a question about where you stand on something this central to economic development and the workforce, which all of these Republicans are crying about. Say nobody wants to work anymore. These are good jobs. These are good paying jobs. And they're standing in the way because of a few DEI policies that 100% of them can't even tell you what that means. It's the same nonsense as like what's happening in Wauwatosa, where everybody is freaking out on the right about this email that somebody sent, kindly requesting some thoughtfulness when it comes to holiday decorations. Not a mandate, not a thou shalt not, not a don't say snowman, say snow people, but just asking for a little kindness, mm-hmm. for a little understanding that not everyone is of the Christian faith. And it is this rush to demonize and radicalize diversity, equity, and inclusion. There is nothing wrong inherently with any of those ideas existing within a public university. And so this maybe more than anything is the one that has me hot and bothered this week, but it's just, it's inexcusable that this is what we're doing, that we're bottling up a $300 million engineering building that'll generate thousands of good-paying jobs, additional good-paying jobs in the next decade because of a few million spent on a few, you know, programs that promote inclusion. What are we doing here?
Well, what we're doing here is asking, since this was probably some of the last floor votes that the legislature will take until sometime early next year, can it still get done early next year, or will Republicans manage to punt this all the way till the next budget cycle? And we don't know. We don't know.
I mean, why would they do it then?
Yeah.
But, you know, Robin Voss says, I don't want to do this. I'm going to throw a temper tantrum, and so we're not going to do it.
All right, last one. Pat Murphy, up or down on choosing him as the Brewers' next skipper?
Great. Excited for Pat. Nice to see him get an opportunity. And really, the Brewers did not play this one particularly well. I'm going to be disappointed for a little while in how this all shook out.
See, that's another one of these bipartisan, doesn't matter what your party is. You're either on team council or team Adonasio or team blame council, team blame Adonasio. And
I'm blaming Adonasio before I'm blaming council on this one.
Mm-hmm. And I think to Pat Murphy, I hope that he is a stabilizing force, shall we say, for the team coming up.
Yep.
And I'm not asking about the Bucks. I'm keeping everybody at their word that we'll wait a few more games into things and then we'll compare.
But you have the receipts. I sent you receipts. So in 20 more games, there will be receipts.
Yes, you too. Joseph Becky, thanks so much. Have a great weekend. So Joe's got opinions on sports here to the point where, Greg, I'm already talking about pre-recording or setting up some end of the year shows for that week between Christmas and New Year's, maybe.
Yeah.
And I'm sure I'm going to get Joe in here. Maybe we can get Mr. Schaefer in here from the Recombobulation area, people who normally talk about news, but we just get to turn on your inner sports talk freak for a segment and just say,
honestly, okay, you do that. You can just be like, all right, guys, talk.
Because as we covered a few minutes ago, there's a lot to talk about this year.
Absolutely. I mean, we had him on As Goes Wisconsin earlier this week, and we didn't get into it, but we got back and forth. I had to actually shush him at one point because he started interrupting. I'm like, I'm not done.
Hey,
I am not finished talking.
Speaking of As Goes Wisconsin,
yes, sir.
10 to noon on many, if not all, of the Civic Media Radio Network stations. I was pleased to be on there last week Thursday.
Yeah.
I'm not scheduled to be there today, right? I'm sure I'm not, because that would explain why last week I was having a panic attack going, I think I'm supposed to be on. As I look at today's calendar, it says I'm supposed to be on As Goes Wisconsin. So clearly when Jane asked me, I put it under the wrong date.
Okay. So, all right, because I don't think you are.
No, I'm sure I'm not. But now I understand why. I was like, where is this? Why isn't this on my calendar? So that'll be a lesson to me. Today's history lesson is coming up after this break. You're up north.
Wish I had you here to home. All I've got is this.
WAUK.
Earn extra cash for the holidays. Visit Robert Hack Diamonds for their gold buying event November 15th through the 18th. They'll buy your gold for real green, and you could walk away with tickets to see the green and gold score a touchdown in Green Bay. Score top dollar with an offer on the spot for your unwanted gold.
There she is.
Hi, good morning.
How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm good. All right, good. You're all lined up and set to go here.
Well, why not convert it to something new and exciting? Or trade in your outdated pieces for something new? So many options. Robert Hack is having their gold buying event November 15th through the 18th and is paying cash for your unwanted gold, silver, and diamonds. See them in Brookfield, just east of Moreland on Greenfield Avenue, or right on the corner of 76th and Layton in Greenfield. Visit RobertHackDiamonds.com.
This is the Shaw, WAUK.
All right, check this out, Kristen Lyerly.
Okay.
Roger did not beat me to the punch this time. Here's John Lennon's Whatever Gets You Through the Night, hit number one this day in 1974. Roger often puts on Facebook some other little music factoid, and I think I've missed most of them. He finds these little things. He puts up today, John Lennon's Whatever Gets You Through the Night reaches number one. Lennon became the last of the former Beatles to have a number one hit after they disbanded. I had it, Roger. I had that one today. And here,
all right, Pat.
He's channeling his inner John Oliver there. Did you hear that?
Yeah. Well, I'm going to get to him in just a moment. I've got that note here on the Puteki Teki. I haven't forgotten that either. Here's the reason why John was last. He was rather withdrawn at that point, post-Beatles. Elton John, who you heard there singing the track, had bet John Lennon that if John Lennon helped him on the song here, it would hit number one. Lennon said no. He lost the bet. And so Elton John made him come up on stage at Madison Square Garden on November 28th of 1974 to a manic ovation. So
oh, my God.
That is the rest of the story.
Nice.
Dr. Lyerly, how are you?
I'm good. Good morning, everybody. Joe Zepecki gets me so fired up.
I think we all return the favor. I think we're all good for each other that way. And yes, Joe was definitely fired up and ready to go here. And, you know, before I forget, we talked about As Goes Wisconsin just before the break here. So let's bring it up again. Are you on today with Greg and Jane and folks?
I sure am. We're talking about bladder health.
All right.
Bladder health. I will not be on the show today. So you just get Jane and Carol.
Come on, Greg. You can participate today. You have a bladder.
How do you know? You don't know me.
I'm guessing.
Moving on. Let's stay with the Beatles theme. It was on this day in 2010 that
let's move on.
For the first time, the Beatles music was available for digital download as iTunes added the group's catalog so you could download tunes like this.
Just a good song.
Love this one.
Anytime I'm like, I just need to listen to something, it's the Beatles. Yep. I just always default to the Beatles.
And then a personal aside on this one, Day Tripper was also my dad's CB radio handle. Remember when CB radios were the thing back in the day? Because almost every day he had to make the trip between Eau Claire and St. Paul because he worked for the railroad. And sometimes he had to travel to one end of the line or the other. So Day Tripper was his... so he picked the Beatles song. Good job, Dad.
Nice. Your dad was cool.
He was. Totally
was. What was your handle, Pat?
I did not have CB. I had a Fisher-Price CB radio back then. So I'm like 9 years old.
Breaker, breaker. This is Word Nerd. Word Nerd coming in. Anyone hear me?
Actually, my teachers would have loved that.
Nailed it.
Yep. Pete Davidson has a birthday today. If you had taken a bet that Pete Davidson wasn't going to make it to 30, you lost. He's made it.
Love Pete Davidson so much. Love him.
Number one song this day in 1985 was by Starship.
We built this city.
Yeah, don't say you weren't warned.
We built this city on rock and roll.
Some people,
Greg with the fist pumps down in the Brady Bunch corner.
Some people, starting with Blender magazine many years ago, rated this the worst song of all time. which was such so wrong, because that could never be true as long as Sister Christian by Night Ranger is still floating around out there.
When I was in high school, that song was out, and people used to call me Sister Christian.
Oh, I get it. I see what you did there. Yeah.
I have a fun factoid about this that you, Dr. Lyley, and Roger Frost don't know about this song.
Oh. Ooh.
A city built on rock and roll, unstructurally sound.
Roger, what say you?
Look what Roger's got. Roger's got, you forgot C.W. McCall's birthday yesterday.
Oh, God, Roger.
Did I? I guess I did. Maybe I did.
Okay. Guess your own radio show, Roger.
I know why. No, I love when Roger does this. I know why. Because recently was the anniversary of Convoy hitting number one on whatever year that was. So we'd already played it not that long ago. So I should have mentioned his birthday, but I didn't put up the song. Pop group Milli Vanilli stripped of their Grammy Award this day in 1990. Because it turned out they did not sing on the Girl You Know It's True album. It was all session musicians who had provided all the vocals. Do we all feel like we lost our innocence a little bit this day in 1990?
No.
Like what's real? I can't tell.
I was 12,
Okay, never mind. Moving on.
I heard there's a documentary coming out. Yeah. If it's not out already.
Yes. I'm excited. Out already, and I hear it's really good.
Mm-hmm. Ooh, what's it on?
I think it's on Hulu.
Mm. On the Hulu.
On Hulu.
All right. For this next one, this is again, anybody of a certain age, feel free to sing along, because 48 years ago today, this day in 1975, a variety show debuted on ABC. Not just any variety show, but a variety show with two of America's sweethearts.
Oh. You might
I for sure watched this one faithfully.
Oh, Marie Osmond.
And the ice skating.
I love the ice rink, yeah, on the stage that they. It was really interesting. Donnie and Marie premiered this day in 1975. I sent that clip and this next one to my sister. My younger sister was enthralled with Donnie and Marie. And that's why Donnie and Marie was the first concert I actually went to, because I was dragged along because she wanted to see them. You know, they were at the State Fair one year. So, and of course, not only is this the anniversary of the show starting, but this is the anniversary of one of their shows ending. It was on this day in 2019 that they played their last show at the Flamingo in Las Vegas, where they'd started their residency 11 years earlier. And so after 1,730 performances, I'm guessing that this was their closing tune.
May tomorrow be a perfect day. May you
find. Yeah, I always found this part of the show to be boring.
Oh, come on.
Like, bring on the ice skating.
Killjoy.
Marie dressed as Dorothy. Good luck. I got the papers.
Gather.
Do you remember how many variety shows there were back then? Oh, it was them and Sonny and Cher and Bobby Vinton. And, like, everybody had a variety show.
Yeah.
Smothers Brothers.
It was great. That was how you saw the wide range of entertainers, how you could be exposed to things you might not normally listen to.
It was like the reality TV of the day.
Yep. We'll get to the many national days today coming up after the news. Kristen, a quick note on hometown health, childhood vaccinations, right?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
What else do you want to know?
That the percentage might be low, like troublingly low, too many exemptions.
Yeah.
So we'll talk. Well,
Wisconsin has too many exemptions. So we're going to talk with a Wisconsin pediatrician about how we can do better.
There you go. That's coming up right after the news here on Up North News Radio for this Thursday morning. Back in just a bit. May God keep you
boring
in his tender care till he brings us together again. Good night, everybody.
Are you wearing your purple socks?
That's right. He was Mr. Purple before there was Prince.
Mm-hmm.
Forgot all about that.
Who was?
Donny Osmond. Wore purple socks.
Yeah.
Oh. Good to know.
It was a thing. That was also how I learned about Mormons.
Oh, yeah, I suppose.
Are they Mormons?
Oh, Greg.
Really?
Okay, so I probably knew that a long time ago, but because of my extensive, like, everyone's like a Mormon. Like, now that I'm, like, really into knowing about Scientology, I'm not a Scientologist. I'm knowing about Scientology. I forgot all the. That's right, they're Mormons.
They came from this giant family with all the brothers. Yeah. Marie was the only sister, and there were, like, five brothers, six brothers.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
There were six, because there was Donnie. There was the five of them, and then there was Donnie. So there was Wayne, Merrill, Jay.
Oh, Merrill.
Merrill. I'm missing one or two. I used to know them.
There are nine children.
Oh, okay. Oh, yeah, that's right. There was little Jimmy. Jimmy joined later.
Jimmy! Yes!
There's Verl, Tom, Alan, Verl. Wayne, Mail, Merrill, mm-hmm. Jay, Donnie, Marie, and Jimmy.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. How about that?
Verl and Tom were both born with severe hearing impairments.
Oh,
okay. And some you of know these what? I remember them.
Well.
I remember them being on the show with their hearing impairments. I remember them talking about it, which was like probably really groundbreaking at the time.
Yeah.
Although a lot of 70s TV was groundbreaking. We just didn't know it.
Yes.
Yeah. Not, and when people are like, people say things like, oh, you know, as those shows haven't aged well, I'm like, no, they've aged perfectly well because we were having those conversations then.
Uh-huh.
Right. And then we just decided in the 80s, oh, it's all over. We're good. Life is fine. Mm-hmm. I don't need to talk about it anymore.
Yep.
How big can my hair get?
Right.
That was my primary
concern. How big did your hair get, doctor?
Oh, I have pictures.
I was going to say, you've posted something kind of like a picture or two about that.
Did you have like long straight hair and then just the poof right here, right? Like.
No, I always had a perm, so it was curly everywhere. And I used to have a lot of hair, so permed lot of hair. I could make it big.
Oh, yeah. That's when I met Sherry. It was perms for, I don't know, at least almost 10 years. And then it was, you know, kind of straight after that. But now we look back at them and go, really? Were they perm? Like, yeah, perms all the time.
They're back.
Everywhere.
Boys getting perms. Like, my friend told me, he's like my son's friend spent $300 to perm his hair.
Ooh, no.
I beg my hairdresser every time I go in, and she always says, no, Kristen, no. But also, she doesn't know how to do perms.
Yeah, no, I was going to say, it's kind of a lost art. Yeah,
yeah. When I went to barber school, they showed us.
You went to barber school?
Yeah, I'm a trained barber. I'm a...
What?
I've gone through my own boards, doctor. I've gone through my own boards.
I had no idea.
Yeah. But they showed us how to do it a little bit. And they're like, you won't have to learn how to do this. And like 2 years later, people were like, can we get perms? We're like, we don't do them here. We don't do them.
They can't be that hard because most of mine were home perms.
Roger. Roger chimes in. I was shaggy.
We need to get you in studio with Greg and he can tune you up.
Roger.
I think she was talking about Roger, making shaggy.
Gotcha. Oh, I was going to say, has amazing hair. Have amazing hair.
Actually, thank you. It's the same thing I've been wearing since 1979. I just kind of, I've been bald since then. I just kind of trim it. Now I gray it a little bit and, you know, very distinguished now.
Anchorman hair. It is.
Oh, it's always been, depending on who you talk to, everybody else calls it Anchorman hair. The one time a consultant came to the TV station and changed it. And it caused a minor uproar in the Eau Claire area. And it's because he said, that's game show host hair. We need to change that. And so he had it like, you know, cut really short and straight, almost like a bowl cut.
Like a Clooney?
Yes. That's what they called it.
Had a Clooney?
I had to call it Caesar.
It was more like Caesar than a Clooney.
I'd like
and
pictures.
The viewers were not happy. It lasted less than a month, and we're like, no, that's it. That's
game show hair is like, to me, when you say that, I think of a specific like 70s and 80s. So it's
like Wink Martindale or something.
Yeah, it's shaggy on the sides, a little over the ears.
Young Bob Barker, you know.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yep. So it's game show host hair or anchor hair, depending on
that's your good
point
hair.
Of view. It works. You know, we all got to have something. Some people have, you know, like mechanical skills or. muscle mass. You know, some people know how to use power tools.
Perfect hair.
I got hair, and I can say words goodly. So I got that much.
Captain Good English.
Mm-hmm. All right, Kristen, so we got you till 7:20, and then we got Jimmy Koska for 10 minutes to talk about the football playoffs, and then you're back on with Dr. Where is it? Rajiv Naik?
Naik. Like okay. Nike without the E.
Gotcha.
Raj Naik.
Okay.
They call them Nike overseas. They call the shoes Nike.
Yeah. That's interesting. We used to call them early on, like when they first came out. Mm-hmm.
I don't remember that. I was a baby.
Yeah. Back when I was a kid.
I was a child. We didn't have shoes.
Can we talk about
bread bags in my boots? I did.
Yeah. Oh, I did that too.
Me too.
Yeah. Okay.
Can we talk about how Mike Gallagher voted to shut the government down? Mike Gallagher and Tom Tiffany both voted no.
Yeah. Yep. We'll get to that.
All right. Coming back in 30.
Okay.
And all of the other Wisconsin GOP congressional folks voted yes.
Mm-hmm.
You can always continue the conversation on social media. Share your thoughts when you find and follow Civic Media on Facebook, X, and Instagram. Your home for the Devil's Advocates. Weekday afternoons from 4 until 6 on The Shaw, 540 AM and 101.1 FM, WAUK.
All across Wisconsin from Civic Media, this is Up North News Radio. Now, live from our Lake Wasota studio, here's the founding editor of Up North News, Pat Breitlow.
On this Thursday, November 16th, here along with the Dr. Kristen Lyerly and with trained barber Greg Bach.
Although, this is not meant to be an insult, but Greg, you wouldn't know to look at him because he's got a lot of hair.
Wow, get out of this one,
Greg,
Kristen.
Greg is a hairy man. Look at that. Woo! He's Fabioing right now.
It's a luxurious mane that he's got there.
And the beard. I mean, Greg's got a lot of hair.
I just look like Fabio's older, less successful brother.
We covered a lot of ground during the news break there, which you can always catch the live video feed on Facebook. Kristen and her many years of perms. Uh-huh. And how I've had the same TV anchor, game show host hair since 1979 when I got rid of the bowl cut. Except for that one very short period at TV 13 when we went back to what they called the Clooney. The Clooney or the Caesar.
If anyone has any pictures of Pat with a Clooney, please.
No,
Dr. Kreitlow. Dr. Kreitlow, it's imperative you come through for us right now.
Stat.
Honestly, there are not. There's one short film clip. Because it was right around Christmas time. They changed in early December. And we filmed like these Christmas greetings. They were like these little vignettes. And they're supposed to be little funny things. And for ours, what we decided to do was you see me walking down a hall at the station. And I come underneath the mistletoe just as a female coworker comes under the mistletoe. And all you see is her coming at me. I look up at the mistletoe. She looks at me and deadpans, not with that hair. And then walks away. So it's like, we let the viewers in on the joke that I get this is a terrible hairstyle. And it went away during the Christmas break. And I don't know if that consultant was ever heard from again.
Okay.
So we've told some nice stories before we even tell you what's coming up on this Thursday, November 16th. Jimmy Koska will join us in a few minutes to talk about the high school football championships that get started today. And then Kristen will have hometown health at the bottom of the hour, childhood immunizations. You have a physician talking to us about their importance.
Mm-hmm. Dr. Raj Naik from the western side of Wisconsin is going to be on talking about what it means, why it's important to have your child immunized, and what's going on in Wisconsin. We're seeing that kids are being less immunized, especially since the pandemic, and actually childhood immunizations are down 1% over the last year. So we've got to get it together. We've got to talk about why this is important and make sure we're having these conversations so that we're making informed decisions for ourselves, our kids, and our communities.
Literally, get it together, people. Come on. Mm-hmm. Thursday, November 16th means it's Great American Smokeout Day. So if any of you are trying trying to quit today, we wish you all the best and hope it extends into tomorrow. This is National Rural Health Day. Kristen, we could have done 2 hours just on that, you know, subject near and dear to our hearts.
Every day is Rural Health Day for us, Pat.
It really is. It's National Fast Food Day. It's National Clarinet Day. It's National Button Day. It's World Pancreatic Cancer Day, and it's World Philosophy Day. So today would be a good day to quote your favorite philosopher. For me, it'd be Jimmy Buffett. If we weren't all crazy, we would go insane.
Wait, what? Pat, what's today? It's World what?
Philosophy Day.
Is it, though?
I see what you did there. Luke Mathers is on the way as well, and you can always join us at 844-967-2789. We spoke very briefly. Oh, Kristen has her hand raised for our radio audience. Yes, Kristen.
It's my number two son's birthday.
May we ask how old?
He's 23. Happy birthday, Julian.
Julian is 23.
May you get up before noon.
Wait, I thought you wanted to have a happy birthday. All right, Julian, happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday, buddy.
We talked a little bit in the last hour, just briefly, about the government shutdown being avoided. The House came up with a plan, an unusual plan. It kind of kicks the can down the road. The Senate went ahead and okayed it. President Biden is going to sign it. There shouldn't be any problems, you know, for the holidays. But here was this way to get around having a government shutdown over the holidays. Kristen, I do not believe every Wisconsin Republican supported that. Some gave the indication they would welcome a government shutdown over Thanksgiving.
Yes, there were two, Terrible Tom Tiffany and, shockingly, Mike Gallagher, who is supposed to be so moderate, voted against this, voted to shut the government down.
This seems a little odd, and the Journal Sentinel went and looked for people's reactions or members of Congress, and at the time, and I haven't seen an update, but his office was not available for comment.
Weird.
Why?
Yeah. That seems to happen a lot. You know, he doesn't really seem to put a lot of information out there, and just kind of waits for the news cycle to drift. But I think this is a big deal. This is somebody who really wants to present himself as a moderate Republican. And I mean, voting with Tom Tiffany when Fitz and Glenn Grothman and Brian Seile, they're all, even DVO, all of them voted to keep the government open. But Mike Gallagher voted against that.
It made for a very unusual week, and we really got to see some people's truer stripes. Now, Tom Tiffany's stripes were always apparent because here's a tweet from him yesterday saying the Biden administration is freeing up $10 billion for Iran after they funded and trained Hamas to slaughter Israelis and Americans. Why is Joe Biden funding terrorism? Again, there's nothing but bad faith out of this guy. He's so far gone over the edge. Mm-hmm. But the other example of people who are appearing moderate and really aren't, Nikki Haley was on with Sean Hannity night before last, I think, and unless it was last night. And her quote was, "If I become president, we will get out of the Human Rights Council. We would certainly not get back into the Paris Climate Agreement. We would get out of the World Health Organization. We would defund the UN as much as possible." Can we finally stop calling Nikki Haley a moderate? She just looks more sane next to all the other weirdos on stage, but her ideas are as weird as the rest of them.
She is trying to walk this fine line where she keeps these mega people happy, but also appeals to that middle. But everything that she says betrays what she actually believes in. She is, like you said, just as far to the right, just as extreme as the rest of the party.
And then finally, we have to note in political news that there was a case of global election interference. But as a result, John Oliver did win the New Zealand bird election. The Puteki Teki is the bird of the century. I think that billboard in Manitowoc probably put it over the top. Well, that and about 200,000 other votes for a contest that normally doesn't even get 40, 50,000 votes. So, you know, Wisconsin played its role. But
We went there. We went to the Puteki Teki billboard.
Did you?
We could not.
I know the business it was on the side of a small business, and they really made the most of, you know, getting that attention. So good on them. There's one nice thing to say about this. Well, two. One I said previously is that this group in New Zealand got a lot of good attention. I'm sure they're going to get a lot of financial support for the good things they're doing. But in the news coverage, I did see this. The reason that groups like this should be saluted. Only 40 years ago, only about 200 Pateki Teki were left in the wild because of non-native predators and overzealous boating that wiped out their floating nests. Through grassroots efforts, their numbers have climbed from 200 to about 1,000. So good things happening there. And, you know, if you have to interfere with an election through a comedy show to continue funding these good things, I guess I'm willing to go along with that.
I love that. I think that's how you get things done. You can't be so serious all the time. You've got to add some levity and make it fun, make it worthwhile. Well,
here's the thing. The levity and the fun have done this to us. I would normally give you the 7 a.m. temperatures right now. I couldn't go get the 7 a.m. temperatures because Greg and Kristen had me far too busy talking about Greg's skills as a trained barber and Kristen.
Oh, this is my fault.
I didn't say it was your fault. I said we were having fun.
But, you know, as far as temperatures go, it's going to be a nice day. Everybody enjoy it. Tomorrow's going to be colder. Next.
No, not next. That's why we have a trained and professional meteorologist here. And because of that, we're going to find out that, yes, as Jennifer Wachitsky tells us, it is going to be warm today. It's going to be windy. But, yeah, there's big changes are coming. Jennifer, good morning.
Good morning. Yeah, and today has been, like you said, it's going to be a warm and windy day, but it's definitely going to change by tomorrow. It looks like cloudy skies are becoming cloudy from Madison up towards Wausau and everyone westward today, and then sunny skies from Oshkosh, Waukesha over towards the lakefront. Our warmest day, this forecast comes in today as that warm front fully pushes through. Highs today in the mid to upper 60s across the board. It does look like a chance for some rain coming in tonight for extreme southern Wisconsin and actually around Oshkosh as well. Friday, a cold front pushes through, so we'll see a pretty significant drop in temperatures. Sunny or becoming sunny for all. It looks like mid to upper 40s for southern Wisconsin, then upper 30s to low 40s from Amory through Wisconsin Rapids and over towards Oshkosh. Saturday, it looks like a brief warm front comes into the area, so kind of this roller coaster ride of temperatures for the next several days. Warmer overall here on Saturday. It looks like sunshine expected with highs in the upper 40s to low 50s for most. Our coolest spot around Wausau lingering in the mid 40s, and our warmest spot around Richland Center and for southwestern Wisconsin getting into the mid 50s. Then actually a high pressure settles in for Sunday, so it looks like similar day to Saturday. So Sunday, it looks like the weekend looks pretty decent, and both days going to be pretty similar.
It's going to be quite a difference between the state high school championship football games that are played today versus the ones that are going to be played tomorrow. Jennifer, I want you to know what a team this is that we have here on your behalf. You work and provide the forecast, of course, for several different radio stations. Not that long ago, Kristen Lyerly here recorded her car radio.
I hear you in Hibbing.
So she was so concerned about whether we're saying your name correctly that she now has sent me an audio file. I don't know if it was to shame me or for affirmation. So if you would please, Jennifer, would you please give us a sign off with your name?
Thanks for the. I'm meteorologist Jennifer Wojcicki.
What do you think, Kristen?
Yay! Perfect. She says it exactly right.
She says it perfect.
Good job, person with your name.
I think it was supposed to be about me. Jennifer, you're such a good sport. Thank you so much. Have a great day.
No problem. Thank you.
Okay.
I did do that. That
you
is
did
true.
Do that. You did.
The first time I heard your voice, name. I was so excited.
I'm like, I don't think I'm that far off.
No, you weren't that far off.
And at no point has she ever sent an email going, hey, no, she's got a very authentic way of saying it because it's her own name.
It's Vukitsky. We got to remember that for Luke because Luke tried to pronounce it and he added way too many syllables.
Jimmy Koska, there's a name that's easy to say, is going to be coming up next. We're going to talk about the high school football championships. Kristen, we'll see you at the bottom of the hour for Hometown Health.
Sounds great.
And then again later for public service announcement on As Goes Wisconsin here across the Civic Media Radio Network. Back with Jimmy next.
WAUK.
Hey there, Dr. Nike. How are you?
I'm good. How are you guys?
Good, thanks. Hey, I just wanted to let you know we did see you here. You look good. You sound good. So
great.
We will be starting our segment with you at just after 7:30. So if you want to hang out there in the virtual waiting room, we'll put you back in there and catch you in a little bit.
Awesome. Thank you.
All right. Thank you. Mr. Koska, how are you? Can't hear you, though. Are you hearing us, Jimmy, all right? Okay, are you hearing me now?
I am okay. Hearing you now.
Hey, there you are. Now we're hearing you. Okay, good. Just wanted to make sure. Good.
Oh,
you're on Brewing Diamonds. See them in Brookfield, just east of Moreland on Greenfield Avenue, or right on the corner of 76th and Layton in Greenfield. Visit RobertHackDiamonds.com.
The Shaw, W-A-U-K, U-K.
We are the champions, my friends.
Oh, there's going to be a few high school crowds singing that later tonight, only on one side or the other of a football field as the boys football tournament continues for the WIAA, and Jimmy Koska's been nice enough to join us these past few weeks to take us through it all. Now the big thrilling conclusion tonight, Jimmy. Good morning. How are you?
I'm doing fantastic. Yeah, you hear that song quite a bit this time of year.
And for good reason. I mean, it is as anthematic as it gets for how you feel, you know, at the end of a long-fought season. And so this is going to wrap up at Camp Randall today and tomorrow. So for folks who are not familiar with how this all works, how do they structure what happens at the stadium over these 2 days?
So there are 7 divisions in high school football for 11 player. So today they'll run through the smallest schools, Division 7 through Division 4. The games will kick off at 10, 1, 4, and 7. And then tomorrow will be Divisions 3 through 1. Those are the 3 largest division schools, and those are at 10, 1, and 4 o'clock. So you only get that one game that's got that 7 o'clock kickoff that's fully under the lights, which is actually a pretty neat deal. But yeah, they play 7 games, 4 today, 3 tomorrow. For people that go, there's not a lot of time like between games. So it's a really nice setup for people who go to take in like the full day, the full experience, that you don't have to wait a lot of time between games. There's usually about 35 minutes or so just in between, and then boom, you're right back onto the next one. So it's a pretty cool experience for people that do go and try to take it all in.
Do you know, I don't know that you can necessarily tell whether, you know, how much of the crowd is kind of locals versus, you know, folks who are bussed in for their various schools. Is it a fairly popular activity for folks around Madison to peek in?
I think that the bigger neutral crowd is the football coach. The football coaches from around the state that come in as part of the Coaches Association. Mm-hmm. They usually tend to be in a big chunk of it. I don't know that there's necessarily a big walk-up, and it's a little hard to tell because you're usually focused when you're doing a game or you're covering it on like that pocket of people that have the signs and the school colors and the people leading the chants. And those people usually, you'll see it on the, when you watch it on TV, or if you're there in person, you'll see it. They kind of form like a pocket kind of around the 50-yard line, right. And then you can just see kind of the school representation, and then the more neutral people will kind of be to the sides or a little further up. But I imagine there's some walk up. There's a good number of people who go to this, and I will say that for people who do go or watch it on TV, it's not going to be filled like it is for a Badgers game when you've got 80,000 people there. Typically, state football is going to be, in the 10,000s, somewhere in there. Not quite to capacity, but still a lot of people show up for this.
Well, I'm going to sound really harsh here, but, you get a high school crowd together, you kind of squeeze them all together so that they all fit in the TV camera shot, much like they do for the Badgers, for as empty as the student section is for the first 3 quarters of the game. But I digress. That's a subject for another day. Let's walk through these. Let's work our way from 7 up to 1, because starting today at 10 a.m. is Division 7, and that's Edgar versus Blackhawk Warren. Tell us, Edgar is one of those that both teams are 12-1, and Edgar's one up here off Highway 29. So I'm familiar that region is kind of a football powerhouse.
Yeah, Edgar actually this year, among those 12 wins, they defeated a team that's playing for the Division 6 title in Stratford this year. So they actually beat them back in week 2. They haven't lost since week 1, and Edgar's at state for the 14th time. That's more than anybody in the state in history. One cool thing about Edgar that I personally enjoy is that they have won football championships in divisions 4, 5, 6, and 7, which hasn't been done either. So I find that fascinating.
Oh, sure. Rightly so. And yeah, Stratford moving to Division 6 is, again, in that same general area. They are taking on Darlington. So again, I'm not as familiar with Darlington as Stratford.
Yeah, Darlington is actually a step behind Edgar in terms of state championship appearances at 13. So they are a powerhouse from here in southwestern Wisconsin. Darlington is about an hour from me down here. And then, of course, Stratford, they are a program. They are looking for their 9th state championship. So another one of those powerhouse programs, like you said, from your area. I will say the Division 6 and Division 7 games, and D7 is a rematch of two other state title. Those two teams, Blackhawk, Warren, and Edgar, have actually met twice in the state championship in recent history. The Division 7 and Division 6 games are really, you're getting the blue bloods, right? You're getting the real best programs in small school football in Wisconsin, and I think people will really enjoy that here early today.
Yeah, and that Division 6 game is at 1 o'clock. And then Division 5 is at 4 o'clock today. That's Wrightstown versus Aquinas. I assume lacrosse Aquinas?
Yes, lacrosse Aquinas. They're a team, too, that they've been the two-time defending champion. And, in fact, in their playoff run, took care of a defending champion in a different division, Columbus, which had the state's all-time leading rusher, Colton Brunel, in their fold. So Aquinas is a heavy favorite in the Division 5. It's one of the schools that you know when you talk about private schools being part of the WIAA, along with schools like Catholic Memorial and Regis, where you might rankle some, you know, you might ruffle some feathers a bit, but there's no doubt that Aquinas themselves have done such a great job throughout the season. Wrightstown is looking for their 4th state championship, so they're not it's not a program that hasn't been there before. It's a program that's got a lot of history themselves. So the D5 game should be pretty exciting to check out.
So now here's the part that might be somewhat controversial. So next is the Division 4 game. And like you said, that's the only night game, the only primetime game at 7 o'clock, because they're at 10-1-4-7 today and 10-1-4 tomorrow. I would have thought that maybe for this 7 p.m. game, they'd skip out of order and they'd put the Division 1 game there. I can't be the first person that's wondered if they have ever talked about doing that.
Yeah, I think if they were to do anything, they would just shift the games on day 2, right? They would shift them to later. But the issue is every other year that the Wisconsin Badgers play on Saturday, including this year. So a lot of the setup when you go there as a media person, it's all kind of in place for the Badgers broadcast. So like, sure, you know, the sound effects and the mics in the bowl and everything like that, that's all set up for the Badgers game.
Okay. So 4 is Luxembourg Casco versus Lodi. Any special notes about that?
Yep. I did the Lodi game back in 2017 when they won their first ever state championship. Luxembourg Casco has had just a dominating season and they beat Catholic Memorial level 4. So that should be a really fun matchup to watch in the nightcap on day 1 tonight.
All right. Day 2 starts at 10 a.m. tomorrow. Division 3, Rice Lake versus Grafton.
Yep, Grafton is making it to state for the 5th time. Rice Lake has been there 8 times, and a lot of them in recent memory. Grafton coming out of southeastern Wisconsin, Rice Lake in northwestern Wisconsin. So you get two ends of the state in this one. Rice Lake travels well for these, so that morning game tomorrow should have a lot of excitement to it.
1 o'clock tomorrow is Division 2, Wanakee versus Badger.
Badger is a fun team to make it to state. This is a very run-heavy program, and they've been knocking on the door for years, and they finally get there. Wanakee, well, they're a program that's been there a lot under their legendary head coach, Pat Rice. I've done a lot of Wanakee football in my time, and this is one of those classic matchups. Wanakee has gone more to a spread in the last 5 or so years, so it's going to be a little bit of a contrast in styles, but Wanakee has played in some real thrillers at state over the years, and again, Division 2 with this it's kind of, you know, you kind of have an upstart versus an established power in this one, and I think that should be fun for people to follow.
And finally, Division 1, the championship game at 4 o'clock tomorrow, Marquette versus Franklin.
Franklin has been just a great program over the last few years. Marquette, from the same part of the state down there, has also been a very dominant program in their history. Franklin has one of the top running backs in the state. They've also got a couple of key defenders. Marquette has always got just loaded studs on both sides of the ball. So the Division 1 game this year, I think it'll live up to the billing. It should be a lot of fun to wrap up state football with Franklin and Marquette.
Well, this was fun to hear all about it as the tournament went along. Jimmy, thank you so much for doing this. We appreciate it.
Oh, I appreciate you guys having me for this season. Been a lot of fun to talk about. For the first time this year, all the state football games will be video streamed for free.
Excellent. All right. So look for that as well. All right, Jimmy, have a great day.
Thank you.
Talk again soon. And coming up after the break, Hometown Health, Dr. Kristen Lyerly returns in just a bit. You're up north.
I consider it a challenge before the whole human race, and I ain't gonna lose.
WAUK.
CBS News Special Report. CBS News is learning about a possible deal between...
We really don't do enough interpretive dancing for you, Kristen, do we? Thanks again, Jimmy.
Thank you. Take care.
You're awesome. All right. And let's see. Dr. Knight is back with us.
Dr. Knight, good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you for being here.
Yeah, thanks for inviting me.
I wanted to list off all of the things that you sent me that you do because...
Please don't. Please don't.
It would take the whole episode.
Yeah. Please don't.
This is so important, though. I know with the medical society, this was years ago that we were lobbying about taking the vaccine exemption, the personal exemption away. And it's just so hard. And now after COVID, we're seeing the effects of this.
Yeah, it's just accelerated what was already starting and it's made it worse. So we have a lot of work to do.
We do. But we're doing it together. We'll get there.
We'll keep plugging away.
Yeah. I'm an OBGYN doctor. I used to work with Sherry at Bellin.
That's what she told me. We're here together today. So actually, we've been together the last 4 days. So we've been spending a lot of time together this week.
I'm sure. Yeah. Lots of changes.
Oh, yeah. We got some quite a bit of stuff going on with all our merger and electronic medical records, so we'll be spending a lot of time together.
Uh-huh.
Are you still practicing?
I am. I'm very outspoken about women's health and about abortion rights in Wisconsin. We've got a pretty tough environment for women, especially women who are seeking abortion care. So because I'm so outspoken, I don't practice here in the state. I practice in Hibbing, Minnesota.
Oh, okay. Great.
Yeah.
Yeah. That does makes it challenging. I mean, one of the faces in Wisconsin for vaccine stuff. There's always that potential too, but
yeah,
I've been pretty fortunate so far, but nothing's a guarantee.
Well, and you know, we have to, it's incumbent upon us as physicians to stand up and share the stories of our patients and help people understand what the impact is here. Because all of this political messaging, all of this ugliness that they're putting out there, it's obviously having a terrible effect on populations and individuals. So if we don't stand up, who will?
Right. Yeah. I agree. That's why I do it.
But you have to do it without... stories.
Yeah. Got to try to do it without alienating them, which is the challenging part. But
which is tougher than ever now because used to be, voices of authority are now elites, So
I should mention Pat's wife is an OBGYN doc up in Rice Lake.
Oh, excellent.
Yeah. So we have similar conversations.
Yes.
All right. So we'll get going in a minute and a half here. So
great.
Good.
And then Kristen, I actually had the... Oh, sorry, Pat. Go ahead.
No, are you going to hang around with Luke?
Yeah.
Okay,
can I?
You don't have to run off? Yeah, of course. Okay.
Mm-mm.
Okay. All right. Good.
Yeah, I was going to say the director of Pro-Life Wisconsin, which is an organization that wants no abortions for any reason, not even to save the life of the mother, filed a complaint against my medical license in Wisconsin, even though I haven't been practicing here. I mean, they are just, throwing everything at the wall to see what sticks. So it's good that I'm not practicing in Wisconsin right now. No, self-preservation.
It is. Well, and your willingness to be a face, we talk about that. There's misinformation, disinformation, and then malinformation. And you've been the target of, malinformation where it's specifically targeted at you, which is, it's a problem.
Yeah. But to be courageous and to have a platform like Pat gives us is really important. And we reach places in rural Wisconsin that otherwise people wouldn't get this information.
That's right. Yeah.
All right. We'll get going in 30 seconds here. bring up the commercials.
Unwanted gold, silver, and diamonds. See them in Brookfield, just east of Moreland on Greenfield Avenue, or right on the corner of 76th and Layton in Greenfield. Visit RobertHackDiamonds.com.
Keeping Southeast Wisconsin informed, engaged, and entertained. This is The Shaw. 540 AM and 101.1 FM. WAUK.
That's okay, let's see how you do it. Put up your dukes, let's get down to it. Heaven with your best shot.
Shots will be our subject in just a second on Hometown Health tomorrow. We'll have a couple of our usual Friday regulars. Dan Schumacher will be here, Mark Jacob. But instead of Kia Vakil, who is on vacation, we will meet with our old friend Carolyn Fiddler, who has one of the new newsletters that are put out by Courier Newsroom, parent company of Up North News. Carolyn has State House Action. Mark Jacob and Kia also have newsletters as well. So to learn more about that, go to couriernewsroom.com and subscribe to those newsletters there. All right, Kristen's back with us now. And again, we're talking about shots, immunization types, that is, and some troubling trends. I don't know, were they happening, Kristen, before the pandemic, or did the pandemic really become the starting point of people doing more to avoid childhood immunizations?
They were happening before the pandemic, but the pandemic has definitely accelerated the number of people who are really questioning and avoiding vaccines. And, you know, it's, to be very clear, it's important that you make thoughtful decisions about your healthcare. But in this environment, what we're seeing is people are being influenced by maybe folks who don't have their best interests in mind, who have their own interests in mind. And it's affecting our own personal health, it's affecting our family's health, and it's affecting our community health, which is why we invited Dr. Raj Naik from Gunderson Health System to come and talk with us this morning. Dr. Naik is a proud graduate of the University of Wisconsin School of Medicine and Public Health. He did his residency training at Wake Forest, and he currently functions as a pediatrician and the chief medical information officer with Gunderson, and has so many accolades. It just has done so much for individual health and public health here in Wisconsin, especially the western side of the state. It would take all day to read all of them. But most importantly for our show today, he's the co-chair of the Advisory Council for Immunize Wisconsin, which is a 3-year CDC-funded grant to improve immunization rates throughout Wisconsin. Dr. Naik, welcome to Hometown Health.
Welcome. Yeah, good morning, and thanks for inviting me.
So nice to have you here.
So pediatricians administer lots and lots of vaccines. I'm a mom. I remember those days. From a patient and a family perspective, tell us a little bit about how vaccines fit into ordinary pediatric healthcare.
Yeah, I think that it's really important to understand how important vaccines are, and it's not an understatement to say that it's the most important thing you can do for your child to keep them healthy over the long run. We don't remember it because a lot of us weren't born yet, but in the pre-vaccine era, many of these infectious diseases not only caused serious illness, hospitalizations, but also deaths in young children. And most scientists will tell you that the two most important things for keeping people healthy are public sanitation and immunizations. It's that important in terms of what it's done to prolong our lives and keep us healthy.
Two of the greatest public health achievements in the last 100 years. I think the CDC, maybe 10 years ago, published a big paper about what the important things are that we now take for granted because it's just become part of our daily lives. But I remember my grandfather talking about his siblings that he lost to diphtheria when they were kids. That doesn't happen nowadays because of vaccines.
Yeah, go back a couple generations and you'll hear the stories of polio, measles, and many of these other now preventable infectious diseases that were devastating. But it is interesting that the historical memory can be kind of short, and vaccines, because they've been so successful, that can create some complacency. And we talk about this in terms of like the confidence in something that we do and the complacency that develops if it's so successful that people don't remember about how impactful these infectious diseases were.
Mm-hmm. I want to second that by noting, and again, it seems odd to even bring this up, but when people talk about like how expensive playground equipment is, and we kind of look back fondly at the old monkey bars, and I almost wish the ER docs of those days could come back and say, yeah, there's a reason we improved these products. There's a reason we put better labels on poisons. I remember the start of the whole Mr. Yuck campaign is that, you know, terrible things happened. And immunizations were a part of it. So it is especially puzzling today, but it does remind us that you can't take anything for granted, even something as basic as vaccines, how they work, and fostering public trust in them. But unfortunately, you know, Kristen tells me that we have a vaccine exemption rate that is one of the highest in the country. Can you tell us more about exemption rates, why, what they are, and what it is about Wisconsin that makes our number higher than other places?
Yeah, absolutely. So each state has their own laws about what qualifies as an exemption. And I think we're down to only 14 states in the country that allow personal waivers, or and there are also religious waivers. The most strict waiver is a true medical waiver, and there are a few instances where a child may not receive a vaccine for medical reasons. But the fact of the matter is that Wisconsin's one of the more lenient states for allowing waivers for vaccines for school entry. And you know, we have advocated a number of times to tighten those laws up, but Wisconsin's one of the remaining states that has these very lenient waiver laws. And actually what we know is most vaccine preventable outbreaks emerge in states with these more lenient laws. So unfortunately, we're one of the states that allows just a parent or anybody else to sign a waiver that says, I don't want to get this vaccine, and that satisfies the school entry requirements.
And here in Wisconsin, our non-medical exemption rate, that personal rate, is double the national rate, which is probably why we're seeing so many exemptions here in the state now. And I can share that in my practice as an OBGYN doctor, I find that when I have thoughtful, data-driven conversations with my patients who are wondering whether to get vaccinated, I think it's great as a patient to question, like, why are we doing this, and to really understand what the risks and benefits are. And my patients do have a lot of questions. And sometimes I find that these questions are rooted in information gleaned from social media, conversations with friends, and other non-medical sources. You take care of kids, a very different population than my patients. What are you hearing in your practice when you're having these discussions?
Yeah, I think that's a really, several really important points that you made. One is how information is flowing and how people are getting information. It has changed over the last several years, where more people are seeking information through other means other than their healthcare provider. And so unfortunately, there's a lot of misinformation and specific disinformation where people are intending to deceive that is available. And unfortunately, that misinformation and disinformation gets shared about 2 to 3 to 1. So it's important that as a healthcare provider, that you're open to these conversations and that you know how to talk about it with your patients, not to alienate them, but to really genuinely answer their questions. And, you know, I think most people that earn the trust of their patients don't do it in such a way that these questions are taken in a defensive way or any other way. You know, what we really want to do is make sure that we understand what our patients want to know and give them information in a way that they can digest and then make an informed choice. The least responsible thing that we can do is just tell people, well, you should do it just because. We want them to understand the information.
You took my next question right there. I was going to ask you, it's like, how Have you had to change, you in general, all physicians, had to change your tactics, your communication with people, because you don't want to just say, well, because I said so, you know, because I'm the expert? As much as we'd like that to have enough weight, sometimes it can't compete with Facebook. So do you feel like you and Kristen, yourself and others have had to kind of change the tenor of these conversations in this age of social media information, Raj?
Well, what's really interesting is that a lot of, you get a lot of training in medicine about the science, but a lot of healthcare providers do not have specific training on communication techniques. And so it's one of the things that I do for other healthcare providers throughout the state, throughout the country, is try to help them learn how to effectively communicate about these complex issues and to address the questions that patients and parents have. And so it is something that needs to be taught. It is a skill that needs to be developed, and it's a skill that needs to be practiced. And so, yes, it is important to for healthcare providers to learn these communication techniques so that they don't alienate their patients, and so that they can earn their trust.
And we're talking about the patient-doctor relationship there in the room, but vaccines really affect not only us personally, but populations of people. And we know that we need about 95% immunity in order to protect against these massive viral outbreaks. Currently, the U.S. is at about 93%, so we're lower than goal, and we seem to be trending downward. Wisconsin is probably lower because we've got a lower rate. So in your opinion, what does that mean for all of us, especially our most vulnerable neighbors who have impaired immune systems or might not be able to get vaccines?
Yeah, that's critically important. And I don't like the term herd immunity. I talk about it as population level immunity, which is what you're really referring to. And there, we depend on both individual choices and what you're talking about, which is the common good, public health. And we don't necessarily understand public health really well in this country, because we're definitely a country that's founded on a lot of individualism and a lot of choices. It's kind of the history of how our country was founded. But it is really important in the world of infectious diseases and vaccines to think about the common good. And, you know, when you're vaccinating, you're not just protecting the individual, you're protecting those around you. So, you know, promotion of the common good and protecting all of us is something that we need a little bit of need these public forums to talk about. And it's critically important. It's not just about you. It is about your family, your friends, your community.
And what's the last thing that you'd like to leave in terms of information that our listeners can take away from today's conversation when it comes to childhood vaccines?
Yeah, you know, I think the most important thing is that, you know, your healthcare provider is, you know, somebody that hopefully you want to develop a trusted relationship with, so that they can share this information with you in a way that resonates with you. And the most important thing for us moving forward is to get past the polarization. Like nothing is as easy as a black and white situation. What we need to do is have open conversations, be willing and open to view, you know, the science in a way that's not, you know, littered with misinformation and disinformation, so that we can help you understand how to protect yourself, your children, your families, your friends, and your community.
And can we note just one more time that, especially with COVID, because it was relatively new, the science is changing. And when science changes, it doesn't mean science was wrong. Because I'm sure you hear that, like, well, you guys were wrong about this or that. It means we're still learning and that you want the latest information to work for you.
Right. You know, and that's a great comment and really important. It's not a flip-flop. What it is making sure that we understand how the emerging science is telling us what the next steps are.
There you go. Dr. Raj Naik from Gunderson Health System, we really appreciate you being here for Hometown Health and telling us much more about this important topic.
Yeah, thank you so much.
All right. When we come back, Luke Mathers will join the discussion and we'll wrap things up for a Thursday here on Up North News Radio.
Yay, that was fabulous. Thank you so much.
Yes, well, thanks for having me. Yeah.
Pleasure.
Yeah, you guys did a great job. So thank you so much.
We'll keep working on it. And if Pat generates any social media off of it, I'll forward it to you.
Okay, sounds great.
All right.
Have a great day.
Yep. Have an awesome day. Say hey to Sherry for me.
Will do. All right, bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Get free professional valuations from a local name and trusted company.
Hi, Mr. Mathers.
Hi, Luke.
Hello.
How are you?
I'm good. How is everyone?
Right as rain.
There we go.
There you go. Another old man expression. Man, I'm just racking these things up lately.
Good one. That's a great
Did
one.
Did you know that Pat used to have a Clooney?
What?
That sounds...
Do you know what a Clooney is?
In your basement, weird. George Clooney?
Yeah, what? No. In your basement?
What?
I don't even know where he's going with this.
Where'd you keep George Clooney?
Here we go.
Okay, wow.
This is the Shaw, WAUK.
Hello, I was freezing to death, then it started to snow. So I got down from the trees and started heading for the truck. And that's when I seen it there.
The 30 point
Dang buck.
It. 30 point buck.
30 point buck.
Poor Greg, you wanted to jump in. That timing is everything, isn't it, buddy?
Yeah, what a terrible comedian.
How many points does the buck logo have? I never counted.
We're not here to talk about the bucks, like that logo on Luke Mathers' hat there.
It's not 30, but it's a lot.
We're talking deer hunting season. It's coming up. And that's what we wanted to figure out, where Mr. Bach and Mr. Mathers would be for the big opener.
I will be getting yard work done and having Friendsgiving because I'm not a big hunter.
You're short.
No.
But I'm always,
I'm not a hunter.
It's all about timing.
I already... Interrupting cow. Moo. I always tell people, and I've already made the hot tub joke before about winter sports, but I'm like, you know, if a deer ever walks by the hot tub that Saturday morning, I'll certainly do what I can to wrestle it to the ground. But otherwise,
with bare hands?
Exactly. I'm going to have to leave it to others. You know?
I mean, look at him.
In other news, local radio legend Pat Kreitlow mauled to death in his hot tub by a deer.
Yeah, I don't think it needs to be a 30-point buck to take you out. It probably
doesn't. Oh, please, a fawn.
Fawn.
Yeah.
Bambi.
Exactly. With those little cloven hoofs, they hit you just right, man.
You know, they're hunting up in the UP, and that's where my partner Craig is right now. He's hunting. And I said, how are you doing? And he said, nothing yet, but one of my friends got a 6-pointer. And then his text said, I think it's a little too warm. And I texted back, but not too warm for your friend? So I don't know what Craig is doing up in his deer stand.
Well, there will be.
But he is not getting deer.
No more texting from Craigers.
Oh no, the phone died. I forgot my charger. Deer camp doesn't have the charger. Oh no,
I can't communicate with this terrible woman anymore.
This forest has terrible Wi-Fi. I'm going home.
All right.
So to answer your question, Pat. Yes. I don't. I'll say this. I'll leave it for tomorrow. I won't be deer hunting this weekend. Working on a possible big deal in the Bach household. So,
ooh, okay,
big deal.
Color us teased. That's okay.
Exactly.
I just want good radio.
That's good radio.
Luke, did you ever? Because I've already talked previously about my dad trying to take me hunting and fishing, and you know we really didn't make a connection there. Do you have any kind of history that way in terms of hunting or?
Well, I very much enjoy shooting. So, like, trap shooting throughout Scouts was a big – that's where I spent most of my summer camp.
Oh, that's right. I forget. On the Eagle range. Scout here
so
on the radio.
I'm really good with a bow. I'm pretty good with a shotgun. Rifle, for the longest time, I didn't understand that I was left-eye dominant. So, I was always just shooting off to the left. And so, I didn't realize until probably about 16 – 17 years old when I learned that I was left eye dominant. And then I got really good at shooting for those last couple of years in scouts. But my dad doesn't hunt. My mom's brothers, though, did, but she didn't trust them enough to send. She's one of eight. So there's a lot of stuff growing up, and she didn't really want to send any of her children into the woods with her brothers to try to get even with her from anything that, you know, they might still not be over from childhood.
Oh, this already got dark real quick.
I know. And by the way, Left Eye Dominant is his rapper name when he applied to take the place of the Left Eye in TLC. R.I.P. too dark? Okay.
No, I was really...
I'm like right-handed, so I had no idea that that would be a thing, so I just always would... I would shoulder I would pull the bow with my right arm, and I would shoot with my right on my right side, and I would always be kind of just off, and I was like, what is going on?
Are these the kind of things Cleafish talks about on Raised in Wisco, or...
He probably knew which way to shoot right away.
I'm just wondering if we can get you some therapy on the radio about this. You know,
is that what we're doing right now?
Do you think there's anything therapeutic about this?
I will register absolutely no comment whatsoever.
This is mockery, Luke, not therapy. You've been on this show before.
Rather than people can get their therapy in any form. It comes in many different forms.
Really quick, you and I, Luke, had a conversation last week about. The meteorologist Jennifer, who's on the show every day, and you absolutely butchering her last name, making her somehow more Polish than it actually was. It's pronounced Wuchitski.
I feel like I was close.
We talked about Kristen texted me an audio clip of her saying it on the radio.
Perfect.
Which I should have done when she's on with Chad Holmes as well. So we've engaged in enough mockery here. Let's get to the shameless self-promotion, which is what this is all supposed to be about, because Luke is, as his title indicates, a civic media guy. And so he's here to talk about civic media things, which, of course, has to start with As Goes Wisconsin at 10 o'clock, where Kristen Lyerly will be on at 11:05. Call or text your medical questions there. All right. That's shameless.
It's Bladder Health Month.
Bladder Health Month.
Bladder Health Month.
We all have a bladder.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay.
Allegedly. Yep. Agree to disagree.
You make me trust you so much as a doctor when you have a bladder. Well, thank you.
You're like,
Didn't we just talk about this in the last segment? Like people doubting doctors, like, oh no, if she says it, I don't know. Those elites.
that up north elitist, that fake news about my bladder. I don't have a bladder.
Yeah. Some people don't have a bladder.
Okay. You know what?
But most do.
Oh my God. All right, before this turns relevant. Toward colostomy bags, we're going to turn back to Luke and we should talk about. Well, yeah, that too. Talk about civic media shows, Luke.
Yeah, we've got so much fun going on right now here at Civic Media. We've got a long holiday weekend coming up next weekend. It is deer hunting, though, before then. So several of the radio stations that are musically formatted will be doing some of the deer camp shows this weekend, so you can tune in to WIRI, WRPQ. Download the Civic Media app. You can jump from the talk stations that you're currently listening to here with Up North News to the music formats as well. It's free, easy to download out of the App Store, either the Apple App Store or Google Play Store. And so it's going to be a fun opening weekend for deer hunting. Hopefully there's going to be some excellent stories called in. There's going to be musical requests to go along with some of the favorites from deer camp. And then with next weekend, the Thanksgiving holiday weekend coming up, we're going to have some of the best of programming for our shows, depending on what you're listening to throughout the standard Civic Media broadcast day. Some of the hosts are going to be, you know, taking some time with their friends and loved ones and family members, and they're queuing up some best of.
I wasn't sure what my best of was going to be. Now I know. I'm just stringing together an hour's worth of these segments with Mathers, Lyerly, and Bach. I think... We've had enough of them now that would fill the hour and do so quite nicely. Thank you, Luke. Have a wonderful day.
And I believe there's 12 points on this
podcast. Very good. Kristen, Greg, thank you so much. You guys have a great day as well. And thanks to all of you for joining us. Chad Holmes is up next in Wausau, Stephanie Miller in Madison, James and the gang in Wisconsin Rapids, Earl Ingram across the rest of the Civic Media Radio Network. Remember, wherever you are, all of Wisconsin is America's true up north, and we're glad you could be up here on the lake for a while. Have a great Thursday. See you tomorrow.
The howitzer was in the shop. My stomach was tied into a monkey knot.
From show.